table. All right, guys. It is a cold midwinter day here in the fall of 2021. Here in the collapse of global industrial civilization here at Bugs in a Jar Farm in the Finger Lakes of New York, where the little dog and I are packing up to get the hell out of here for the next 6 months. Here on this freezing Thursday, November 4th, somewhere around there, 2021. We will be on the road tomorrow, but since it is Thursday, I think I've made Thursday my oilprice.com rant, where we simply go over to, we open up my Rolodex of stories from oilprice.com to see how the enemy is tracking the collapse of a planet. You know, oilprice.com right up there with Manga Bay as one of the most trustworthy reportings from the energy sector. So this is, if you were an oil and gas investor, these are some of the stories we're going to, as I do each week, I picked out six stories. I mean, you can go on to oilprice.com and find a lot more, but we're going to look at six stories. And I love the first one. Is there a war brewing in the South China Sea? There you go, oilprice.com. Thank you very much. You know, I have been saying for years that there most certainly is a war brewing in the South China Sea. And it is my personal pick for where World War III is going to begin here shortly. But this is oilprice.com. As far as I know, this is the first time they have ever looked at this. Take it away. Is there a war brewing in the South China Sea? The takeaway, tensions in the South China Sea have been ramping up for years now. Huge overlapping sections of the South China Sea are currently subject to claims by Brunei. Yeah, like Brunei is going to have, let's see how the Brunei Army and Navy defends its claims. Brunei, Malaysia, Indonesia, the Philippines, Taiwan, Vietnam, and of course the big daddy in the South China Sea is of course China. An all-out oil war in the South China Sea would be extremely costly for China and ultimately may not be in the country's best interest. Well, we shall see if we have an all-out oil war. All right. Tensions in the South China Sea have been percolating for years. Even in relatively calm times when the battling claimants of the contested waters managed to stay out of the headlines, the reality out on the sea is rarely tranquil. In fact, a recent report from the South China Morning Post revealed that Chinese boats have been harassing civilian vessels in the Malaysian and Vietnamese portions of the South China Sea, you know, which China is claiming as theirs. Quote, on a daily basis for years. The South China Sea is now a geopolitical hotspot as one of the most important trade routes in the world, not to mention the South China Sea is the home of valuable oil and gas reserves as well as lucrative fishing grounds. The Energy Information Agency estimates that the South China Sea contains approximately 11 billion barrels of oil and 190 trillion with a T 190 trillion cubic feet of natural gas in proved and probable reserves. So the cover story, of course, in all of this is the trade routes is the one they're using as the cover story in the mainstream. The mainstream media never talks about those 11 billion barrels of oil and the 190 trillion cubic feet of gas, never mentioned in the mainstream media. So the mainstream media plays this up as defending trade routes. It's why the U.S. and Britain and all the rest of these warships are over there. I'm not saying that has nothing to do with it, okay, but it has very little. This is an oil war or a gas war. This is going to be a resource war over fossil fuels. China has state claims to the South China Sea at more than 85% of the total area and has been the most aggressive in defending these claims with a huge show of military might and Navy vessels patrolling the waters. And according to the Asia Times, China's most recent rash of aggressions was a bid to shut down Vietnamese resource development projects, quoting the Asian Times, as Beijing aims to force all foreign oil companies out of the South China Sea, leaving itself as the only potential joint development partner to rival sea claimants. I love this. The only joint development partner. there's some good Orwellian speak for you. Vietnam is, just the latest target. Indonesian drilling has also been targeting in the Natuna Sea, and then where they've also been clashing over fishing rights, and now reports Malaysia has been bearing the brunt of Chinese bullying, blah blah blah. The Malaysian state-owned oil company Petronas has been developing oil and gas fields where Chinese vessels have been reported driving dangerously and erratically with the intent of dissuading civilians to take contracts in the area. Yep. Okay, so what is the analysis? An all-out oil war in the South China Sea would be extremely costly for China, not to mention costly for the U.S. and Britain and the rest of the planet, and ultimately may not be in China's best interest. Invading another nation is costly. Yes, and in this region, the battle could easily turn into another kind of forever war. Yep. There are a lot of reasons why China should not and likely will not push its competing claimants hard enough to start a new war. There you go. But Beijing's behavior over the past few years has shown that China is more than willing to test those boundaries. And I noticed that no mention anywhere in this story, about all the U.S. warships. Wasn't there some U.S. nuclear submarine that just had a wreck over there with some mountain in the South China Sea? Anyway, we shall see. I still stick to my prediction Okay, from the South China Sea to the United Kingdom, heat or eat? UK households brace for a difficult winter. More than 3 million UK households are facing a troubled winter in debt to their energy supplier. Half a million more people than last year, according to this analysis, blah, blah, blah. One analysis reveals that 59% of households in the UK say they are either worried or very worried about how they are going to pay for their energy bills over the coming months. 17% of households say they will now avoid putting the heating on even when it's cold. Yes. The anxiety reflects rising levels of debt. Anyway, not looking good. This is Justin Midnight, energy policy expert, blah, blah, blah. Quote, "No customer should have to choose between heating or eating." And it is alarming that many households are facing that decision this winter. Okay. We're going. Well, I guess I should have just stayed in China. We're just going to be bouncing back and forth. So while China is trying to decide what to do about having an all-out fossil fuel war in the South China Sea. Meanwhile, China to make huge bet on nuclear power to reach climate goals. This ought to make James Lovelock and James Hansen very happy that China is making a huge bet on nuclear power. China will rely heavily on nuclear energy in the coming decades to try to reach its own carbon neutrality goals by 2060, as it looks to significantly expand its nuclear power capacity fleet with new projects worth up to $440 billion, according to Bloomberg. Over the next 15 years, the world's largest polluter will seek to build as many as 150 new nuclear reactors, as China has decided to double down on nuclear energy generation. The plans for huge nuclear capacity rollout in the coming years could make China the largest generator of nuclear energy in the world by the mid-2020s, overtaking the United States. In recent years, other countries, after the Fukushima disaster in Japan in 2011, have questioned the safety of nuclear energy and the cost overruns that have plagued several major projects. There you go. We shall see. Save the planet by ramping up nuclear energy. All right, three more here. What is BP? British Petroleum, what is their latest report talking about oil demand? While all those guys over at COP26 talking about how we need to stop pumping fossil fuels, according to BP's newest report, oil demand has already topped 100 million barrels per day. Yep, and demand will continue to increase and reach pre-corona panic levels sometime next year. It is back to business as usual. Global oil demand has already exceeded the threshold of 100 million barrels per day last seen before the pandemic, and it will, you know, be back up sometime next year. BP's chief financial officer, Murray Auchincloss, said Tuesday, quote, somewhere next year we will be above pre-COVID levels. Yep. This reflects the strong rebound in oil demand as the impact of corona panic eases. As we look ahead to the end of the year, we expect oil prices to be supported. You know, this is talking to oil investors, meaning we expect prices to go up for a gallon of gas is what we expect oil prices to be supported by continued inventory drawdown with the potential for additional demand from gas to oil. BP's view about global oil demand is generally in line with most other analyst and industry estimates, pointing to consumption returning to pre-pandemic levels as soon as this quarter or early next year. Yep. So, you know what that means if you are an oil investors. So we're going to wrap up, I guess, with kind of two stories on the same theme. This is oilprice.com reporting from COP26. Yes. Energy prices and climate concerns clash at COP26. Yeah. this is probably some of the more honest reporting we have about COP26. The takeaway: COP26 has already caused plenty of confusion, with countries pledging to limit the rise of global temperatures while also calling for more oil and gas production. The recent energy crunch could not have come at a worse time for COP26, with governments determined to fight climate change and lower energy prices. Yes. Businesses are becoming frustrated by the mixed messages and the lack of clarity. Yes, struggling to set long-term strategies. Okay. It's talking about, you know, this week the leaders of the 20 they're actually talking about the G20 meeting before COP26, where the 20 big guns got together and pledged to limit the rise of average global temperatures to 1.5 degrees Celsius. Also this weekend, U.S. President Joe Biden urged the oil and gas producing members of the group to increase output amid soaring prices. And we're going to wind up with Save the Planet Joe in a minute. And Biden wasn't the only one. The 1.5 degree commitment and the call for more fossil fuel production are so at odds that they would confuse anyone, especially since the climate crisis is routinely referred to as existential, and the action needed on this crisis repeatedly emphasized by all reputable agencies and governments is being hailed as urgent. So how does a pledge to limit global temperature change square with calls for more oil production? Yes. And And then, you know, even oilprice.com laughing off the very notion of limiting global warming to 1.5 degrees. This scenario has been seen by scientists as already impossible to achieve. After all, this scenario would require a reduction of global greenhouse gas emissions by as much as 50% over the next 9 years and to net zero by 2050. The G20 leaders made no firm commitments as to deadlines, only saying that it would aim for net zero, quote, by or around mid-century, close quote. If emissions must be slashed so much and so quickly, then the call for more oil and gas now begins to sound even stranger, as that goes against the G20 pledge and the COP26 pledge. The reason for such a confusing call, of course, is that energy bills begin to weigh heavily on households. Unhappy households contain unhappy voters, so the call for more oil and gas production are understandable coming from elected officials, yet environmental organizations are already unhappy with the G20 commitment, and they are made up of voters too. There you go. With this chaotic approach, it looks like COP26 may have failed before it even started. That's probably the most honest comment on COP26 to date. With this chaotic approach, it looks like COP26 may have failed before it even started. There you go. But we're going to wind up since even the mainstream media having some fun with this one. Our Save the Planet, Joe Biden up there. Joe Biden, OPEC and Russia must pump more oil to help America's working class. Yes. The refusal of OPEC to increase crude oil production is affecting America's working class, Biden said at a news conference following the G20 meeting. Quoting Joe Biden, I do think that the idea that Russia and Saudi Arabia and other major producers are not going to pump more oil so people can have gasoline to get to and from work, for example, is just not right. If OPEC's decision to keep a lid on output has profound impact on working class families, it has profound impacts on working class families just to get back and forth to work and or drive to Florida. yes. The effects of price movements, meaning prices moving up, are already costing Biden approval among voters. His rating is now well below 50%. I heard 42 at the last, with 70% of Americans believing the country is not going in the right direction. At the same news conference, Biden said he was confident the country could meet his administration's goal of emissions cuts, which is 50% from 2005 by the year 2030. Yet, the president did acknowledge that the renewable shift cannot happen overnight. Quote, on the surface, it seems like an irony. Yes, Biden said, referring to his call to add more oil production while heading for COP26 to discuss the reduction of global emissions. Quote, but the truth of the matter is, everyone knows that the idea that we are going to be able to move to renewable energy overnight, it's just not rational. Close quote. Thank you, Joe Biden. Save the planet, Joe Biden. And the rest of those planet eaters, we are going to reduce emissions by ramping up more oil pumping. Thank you, Joe Biden. You are the master of talking about something that is not rational. I love that dude telling us what is or is not rational. Guys, it's all a joke. It is a dog and pony show. It was a failure before it ever started. Right now, more than 100 million barrels per day of oil being burned today. I'm certainly adding to that figure. And my gas sucking truck pulling a trailer heading to Florida. We're going to be right back where we were before Corona panic sometime in the next 3 or 4 months, and going up, up, up. We're burning more and more fossil fuels than we've ever burned in history. This whole damn thing is a joke. And even if we did transition to renewable energy overnight, that's a joke. And even if humans went extinct tomorrow, that's a joke, because temperatures would keep rising but with what's baked into the system. It is time for oilprice.com, the mainstream media, everyone else, just to say, get out there and enjoy it while you still can. And that is exactly what I'm going to try to do on my last day in New York. Well, I can't reach it from here. I must sheepishly admit I have bought my first smartphone. I am now part of the smartphone generation, and I'm going to Verizon boot camp. I just talked to this young man, and he was asking me a few questions to see how big of a Luddite he was talking to. He sized me up quickly, and I guess I'm going to pay $30, and I'm going to go to smartphone boot camp at the Verizon store. He's going to teach me everything I need to know to be a good little smartphone slave. So wish me luck in smartphone boot camp. I will try to get my Manga Bay Roundup ecological rant out tomorrow, but then I'm on the road for a week, guys. We're heading south. So I don't know how many more rants you're going to get in the next week. I don't know for sure what I'm going to find with my internet when I get to Florida. So I will do my best to get some Chronicles of the Collapse out to you. But can make no promises here in the collapse of global industrial civilization. Bye, guys. Okay, little dog. Are you ready to go to smartphone boot camp?